What's going on, guys? Scar coming at you with another Magic the Gathering video, and sorry for the delay in the videos, but we are diving into today's video after I recorded a second time, and that is a video about mulliganing, why you mulligan, kind of the basis of kind of going over just mulligans for newer players who may not truly understand why you would take a mulligan and what situations you'd want to take a mulligan. But first and foremost, I do appreciate you guys coming out and checking out the video. And with that being said, if you like the video, hit that like button. It definitely helps out the channel a lot. If you're new here and want to post more videos, hit that subscribe button. But let's dive into it. So first and foremost, you may be wondering to yourself, what is a mulligan? Why should I care about the rule? How does it benefit me as a player? It may be just one of those things that you see as an option in the arena client or even in physical Magic if you do play that. And essentially what a mulligan is where you take your starting hand if you don't like it, whether it's you've drawn really badly, like you've got no lands or you've gotten no spells and a whole bunch of lands, and you essentially take it, you reshuffle it back into your library and you draw a new 7-card hand. Then you look at that 7-card hand and you choose one card out of that hand and you throw it back on the bottom of your library. And essentially you either decide to keep or remulligan again, therefore repeating the process, but this time because you mulligan twice, you would then take two cards and the process continues, essentially going all the way down until you're at zero cards. So you can mulligan until you have no hand left, which essentially at that point, there's probably just might as well scoop and just move on to your match. But first and foremost, I feel like that's just a general basis. I know it can vary dependent on the deck you are playing, why you should mulligan, how you should mulligan, what to look for, what decide whether a hand is good or bad, depending on your matchup. There's many things that kind of go into play, and it's definitely going to be kind of hard to kind of go on a deck-by-deck basis and kind of tell you what's probably something that you should keep and what's something that you should mulligan. But overall, I'm going to do my best to kind of show you some examples with a couple of different deck types. Just to give you a general idea of what to look for, but the best thing I can say when it comes to mulligan is just play your deck, kind of figure out what is the best way for it to work, and kind of go from there. As you learn your deck, you kind of understand things that work, things that don't work, certain hands and certain things to look for, especially when it depending on the deck you are playing. There's certain pieces that make a deck work, and if those are the pieces that you need kind of early in the game or in the late of the game, you can kind of figure out whether or not it's important to have in your opening hand. So I already actually said this point, and essentially you'd be asking yourself, why would I take a mulligan? And essentially it just boils down to your hand's just not good. And that's really one of the main priorities as to why you decide whether or not to take a mulligan. The other thing too is depending on your matchup, and sometimes, you know, in the arena client, it's kind of hard to tell what you're playing against up, especially in a best of one, because you're only really playing one match and then you're moving on to the next person. But there's always some signs that you can always look for when it comes to a mulligan. You can look at possibly, you know, the sleeves, the avatar. Sure, that's sometimes a joke that, you know, people do make. If they're playing Lightning Bolt sleeves and they have a Chandra avatar, that's more than likely mono red. I mean, I've actually seen it the complete opposite. I've seen them play like white or something completely direct opposite, like mono black. But, you know, it's one of those things that we kind of, you know, you try to pick up on, especially if you're higher ranks in the ladder, for example. I know sometimes you come up against people you've already played before and you can kind of go over their history of what decks they've been playing. That's another reason. With the introduction of companions, the companion actually can be a good key tell of whether or not they are a particular deck. If you see a Lurrus deck, you're more than likely going to think it's probably some sort of budget rogue style deck, or not budget rogue style deck, but like budget in the sense that there's like two cost rogues, like the Dimir Rogues Mills style deck. If it's got a Yorion, you're looking at more of a control style deck. And then, you know, it's one of those things that as you play more matches, you kind of pick up on those details. And this is just another thing to look out for. So if your hand is not good against that particular matchup, you can always mulligan it and hopefully draw cards that you would want to have against that particular matchup to give you the best chance to win. And now we're going to move on to like how you can kind of decide how or why you should take a mulligan. And this, there's a general rule, I would say, when it comes to take a mulligan. I personally feel like just because, you know, the shuffler is sometimes messed up in the arena, I would essentially, you know, look for a 3-card hand, you know, at least 3 lands and some spells to play, especially on the early game, depending on what type of deck you are playing. But, you know, having a decent curb as well as 3 lands is a pretty key card. I would, for aggro, it's definitely at least 2 to 3 lands, depending on the type of aggro deck. Mono red's pretty straightforward that I could see possibly having, you know, 2 lands and 5 spells and hopefully drawn into your lands, as the lands aren't as important because we're trying to end the game by turn 4 or turn 5 in a mono red style deck. Mid-range and control, I would say at least 3 lands are a priority, and depending on what kind of deck you are playing, you know, like a mid-range deck, if it's like a, you know, let's just say you know, Gruul aggro. That's probably a decent mid-range deck that you definitely see around right now. Sure, it's aggro, but I would say it's more mid-range just because of the size of the creatures. Or even mono green food is another good option. As you can kind of see behind me, I have some examples of those decks, but I'm actually going to be going over in future videos. But in those decks, I would essentially say, you know, 2 to 3 lands is pretty good with the mono, with the Gruul aggro. Probably looking for a Fabled Passage in that sense, just because it helps out your Rush Fire elemental. But with that being said, you probably want 2 to 3, you probably definitely want 3 lands, because you definitely want to hit things like, you know, Lovestruck Beast, you know, Bonecrusher Giants, things like that, that you definitely want to hit on turn 3 just to create a threat on your opponent. Definitely makes, you know, your end game a lot easier with those decks, just because they have the Great Henge to help you play a lot sooner. So those are things you want to look out for in those decks. That's why I think essentially 3 lands is probably the best. Then you got control. Depending on what kind of control deck you are, if you're like Demir control or even just, you know, Azorius control, you want some interaction to kind of slow down your opponent. With Demir control, you probably want some removal from the board, be able to mix in a little bit of the counters. Probably for, you know, the Azorius control, you're probably looking for things to get in your opponent's way, whether it's playing things like control again. Things like Birth of Miletus are very important. That will help you get, you know, your additional planes from your deck, allowing you to eventually get a wall on the battlefield, things like that. You know, you're looking for things that are going to hopefully slow down your opponent enough so you can kind of get into your end game. And that was definitely, that's also a deck that you probably want at least 3, you know, lands in your hand. Also, when it comes to, you know, any of these decks besides the mono colors, is that you're probably going to want a mixture of both colors or whatever colors you are playing in your hand, or some way. You don't want all of the red, you know, lands in your hand when you're playing Gruul aggro, when you have green cards in your hand, just because it's going to make it definitely harder. You're not going to be able to hit things when you properly want to hit them, and vice versa. You know, yet again, if you're playing like a deck that, you know, plays a lot of colorless but with like splash of white, like if you're playing like let's just say colorless Ugin, which is a deck I've seen pop up here and there, you're probably gonna want to make sure you have at least one of the the color you are playing as in addition to the colorless mana that you have, just to kind of help so you can play those spells and you're not waiting for that colored mana to be played to play particular spells like removal and things like that. But those are things that you can look out for as you kind of get used to the deck and kind of understand like what things work best and what things work best against other decks. Also, the other thing you can put into account when it comes to mulligan is whether you're on the play or you're on the draw. When you're on the play and you're playing aggro, you want a definitely aggressive hand, especially like in mono red. You probably want to hit definitely your one drop, you want to hit your two drop, and possibly your your three drop. And those are things you probably definitely want in your opening hand. You know, hitting like a Fervent Champion Robber and maybe a Bonecrusher Giant, that's a pretty solid hand for mono red. And, you know, having that 2 to 3 lands will make it very, very good. And, you know, the benefit of that, you can also possibly have an Ember Cleave, or even I think a three drop could even be better. You could also have your Annex, which essentially then would, if as long as you draw your fourth land by the time, you know, turn 4 rolls around, I think that's the perfect hand for mono red. So, you know, things like that, and especially being on the play, you want to be as aggressive. When you're on the draw, you can take a little bit of a different take. You know, you can kind of like, depending on what kind of style deck you are playing, you can kind of think about it. Essentially, because you're on the draw, you get the additional land, the additional card that your opponent doesn't get if they're on the play. So if you do take a mulligan, you kind of do at least go back up to 7 and still have, you know, at least a balanced hand or even amount of cards that your opponent has. Though the downfall is, you know, you are down one card. There's the disadvantage and the advantage of being on the draw, especially being on, you know, waiting to, you know, you're kind of reacting to what your opponent does in the early game, especially playing aggro. So you definitely on the play or on the draw, you definitely want a hand that kind of balances how your deck plays in those certain positions. And yet again, that's something that comes from just playing the deck out. All right. So the next thing I want to kind of go over is essentially, you know, what is a good hand? You know, just some basic examples, you know, as things we were talking about. I do have examples of both this for aggro, and I do also have a Demir control example. And essentially what this is just a tool on Aetherhub. What you can do in any of my decks or any decks that are on the website in general, if this is what you use to look for decks to possibly play. And that is, it has a simulation tool for the decks, and you can actually see example hands. Just to kind of give you an idea of exactly what you have and kind of, you know, figure out whether or not these are good. And this doesn't let you, you know, this kind of lets you actually kind of figure out before you start playing games and have to kind of like figure it out on the spot. So essentially the way the tool works is that it will draw your 7 card hand. I know it's a little bit tough to see just because if it's a little bit smaller, if you're like watching on your phone or something, the cards are possibly a little bit smaller. I'm trying my best to get as big as possible so you can kind of still see like everything going on the website. But essentially what this happens here is, I'll show your hand. In this mono red hand, we have a pretty decent hand. I wouldn't say it's the best mono red hand I've ever seen. This one plays a little different, some different cards that you may not see in typical mono red decks, but overall the deck does perform fairly well in a best of one. But essentially what the deck, this hand has, is two mountains, as you can see here, one here and one there. So it's definitely a two mountain hand. We have a Spikefield Hazard as a one, you know, as that spot removal in the early game, which definitely can get rid of other, you know, small creatures that your opponent may be playing, or it can be a modal land, which you can play as a land. In this situation, you may want to play it. But I mean, overall, we got a pretty solid hand. You know, you got the Fireblade Charger, you got the Fervent Champion. We have the Brimrock Knight to pump up one of those creatures or also play it on the battlefield. And then we also have a Torbrand as long as we have to turn four. And then we can take a draw if we want to see what the next card we would draw, especially if we're on the, you know, the play. We can see what our following turn would look like. So we drew another land, which that means I think we're actually flooding, which is actually not great for mono red. But the benefit here is that maybe we now don't have to play the Spikefield Hazard tapped into play as a land. We can now leave it as a quick one spot, you know, the 1 point of damage removal, which is definitely very good. But overall, this is definitely something you can do. We can hit, draw a new hand completely, so you can take another look. This one's actually a very flooded hand, essentially. This one's actually four. But I mean, you know, it's one of those beggars can be choosers. This is actually probably something that I probably wouldn't keep. I mean, it's decent, but it's not great. You're hopefully gonna you want to draw into more stuff, because we only have really a Fervent Champion, Flybrave Charger, and we have the Bone Crusher Giant, maybe as a spot removal and also a turn three. And then we have three mountains and a Castle Embreath, which is okay, but it's not the most aggressive hand, especially being on the play. You would want something probably a little bit more aggressive. We take the draw and see what happens. We draw another land. This hand now turned into kind of like really reflooding, and you know, essentially turn two goes by, we play another land. Okay, we really need to be drawing more. We draw another land. This is definitely not working out for us. And we are completely flooding, and we're kind of now in a position that hopefully on turn four we would draw something. And we would draw another Spikefield Hazard into eventually an Annex on turn five, which, depending on the matchup, it may be too slow to, if our opponent is playing something a little bit slower or more mid-rangey, we're not hitting them hard enough before they really get their stuff out on the battlefield. So this definitely would not be the way to go. You know, four, as you can see, four lands in an aggro hand is actually not great. You probably, like I said, three is probably the maximum. Two's okay if it's a very good hand, but it's one of those things you got to find your balance and kind of go off of like what, you know, games you've had, like how do two drop games, two land hand games go, how do three drop land, three land hands go, and that's how you kind of have to figure it out. So this next one is actually a Dimir control deck, which essentially is a deck that's actually pretty decent. This is another deck that I'll probably be going over in a future video, but essentially what this is a control deck, and this is actually where you can kind of look at this and maybe understand whether or not this hand is good. Looking at it, the hand's okay. It's not great. It actually has a lot of lands. It has four lands in the hand, and we actually have a lot of expensive spells in our hand. So we have, as you can see, we have the Ugin Spirit Dragon, and we also have the Extinction Event, which essentially those are two very large spells, and our only early game interaction is really the Heartless Act. Now, this is one of those things, if we're on the play, maybe this is something we would keep, because we have an interaction on turn two, at least remove, you know, a creature from the battlefield. And then if we're on the play, you know, or if we're on the draw, you know, you can take your draw, which would be another land, which is not looking great. You know, we're really flooding and we don't really have a lot of interaction. I mean, sure, we can take the Triome and we can tap three to draw a card, but that's not really what we want to do with that card, just because it's like a dual land and it can do both ways. Sure, we have the pathways that can be both swamps and islands, but you know, drawing a fifth land is not great. On the following turn, we do draw an Elspeth's Nightmare, which actually I think comes in at a good time, just because this would be turn three, which could, you know, remove things. But yet again, we're not really getting that mid-game interaction. We probably at this point probably have already played the Heartless Act. You know, Elspeth Nightmare is gonna maybe rid of another small creature our opponent is possibly playing, and then after that, if there's things on the battlefield, I mean, Extinction Event hopefully hits something. If it doesn't anything, it's kind of a, you know, card that's just sitting in our hand and doesn't do anything, and we're still a long ways away from Ugin. So this is one of the situations where a four land hand is kind of risky, in the sense of, sure, it could be good because maybe you've drawn like a good chunk of your lands off the top of your library, and then eventually as the game goes on, you'll draw more deeper into your library. But let's take a new hand and kind of go over this one. So this is another hand. This is actually one of those situations where this is actually probably not the best hand, in the sense that we have, you know, we have a swamp, we have a Crawling Barrens, and that's it for lands. So it's a two land hand. We also don't have any blue mana, which is a double blue for the neutralized. So this is a card that we essentially can't play, at least for two turns, until we draw two more islands. Though the benefit of it is we do have Heartless Act for removal. We do have a Maze Mind Tome for the draw. Depending on, we actually have two Heartless Acts, I just realized. So this is one of those things where it's okay, but yet again, we're looking for the blue mana, which we don't have. Sure, we could always take the neutralize and we can always cycle it to draw a card. If we do go to the draw, hopefully we draw a blue land. No, we actually draw the Arteris, the Oracle of Half-Truths. So this gets us in another weird position because yet again, we still have another blue spell in our hand that we can't do anything with. This turn, we'd probably play in the Maze Mind Tome, depending on what our opponent's playing, or possibly the Heartless Act, or leaving that open. So we have things that we can do to kind of slow down our opponent, hopefully not get too aggressive on us. Ashiok's Nightmare, things are not looking great. We're only at two lands still, so we're on turn two, three. We would have to probably take the Maze Mind Tome, tap to draw a card, which would then get us another Maze Mind Tome, so then essentially we're out. And this is one of those things where you keep two lands, especially in a control deck, and we start missing our land drops, and our hand becomes kind of clunky. We really can't do it. So this is definitely one of situations where you probably would want to mulligan if you only have two lands, because the ideal thing is you want to at least have three lands, because that guarantees you at least three lands for the first three turns. So we'll just do one more, look at it again. This one, yet again, not great, but it's not terrible. And this is why it's not great and not terrible. It's kind of in that middle ground. It's like a moderate hand. Because we have Temple of the Seat, one, we can kind of like scry the top card of our library, figure out if it's a land or, you know, an interaction spell and put on the top or bottom. So there's that. Two, we also have Crawling Barrens on turn two. We can essentially then play Omen of the Sea, or we play Heartless, or we can play, keep it open for Essence Scatter. We can always, you know, leave our mana open, wait to see what our opponent does, and go from there. So if we were to play, you know, the Omen of the Sea, we would draw a card, which we draw a swamp, we go to three lands. So we're doing okay in that sense. And also with Omen of the Sea, we would have scryed the top two cards of our library, drawn the cards we wanted, put whatever we want on the bottom, and then essentially move on from there. So it's possible that we would have maybe set up two turns of lands, and if that happens, another land. We're doing good, though we are in an awkward position because now we actually don't have double blue, which gets a little tough if we draw neutralize. But we do have enough land to play the cards in our hand, minus the Ashiok, which is the turn five. But we're on turn, I think, three, and we have four lands in our hand. So if we don't draw a land on our next turn, we would essentially be okay. But the following turn is the one we would want to draw a land. So let's draw more times, see how it goes. And we draw Jirari Disruption, which is not terrible, but the only problem is it is we'd have to take this card. But by this point, the Jirari Disruption, unless our opponent's playing really things on curve, it may or may not be very dominant or very it might not be very good for what we're up against. So you can actually take this, put in the battlefield tapped, which would then delay our Ashiok Nightmare's Muse by a turn, which is okay depending on the matchup. But yet again, we've hopefully at this point have just got away or got out of this situation. But yet again, it's one of those things, as you have deck knowledge and how your deck plays, these are things you can kind of pick up on and kind of figure out whether or not you're in a good situation or a bad situation depending on the cards in your hand. So, I mean, essentially, you know, it's something that you just build up over time. So, I mean, in conclusion, I mean, overall, the mulligan rule is, I think, a very good rule for Magic, because, I mean, the worst would be getting a hand that just kind of stinks. Though I will say, sometimes in the arena, you would just, you're like wondering who shuffled my deck, because sometimes you get clumps of cards that are all together. Sometimes you get like three card land hands, and then you never draw any lands for the rest of the game, and you're like, I don't know what's happening. So, I mean, like I said, for the safety measures, I would always say three is the ideal for most decks. In certain situations, two can be okay if you have ways to maybe, you know, get a little bit deeper into your deck to hopefully draw your additional lands. But yet again, you're putting yourself at the risk of, you know, if you miss your lands, you're then missing your land drop for the turn, especially in the early game. That can be very detrimental to how your field's going to build up if you really can't play all your drops when you're supposed to play them on the turn you're supposed to play them. With that being said, guys, if you like the video, hit that like button. Definitely lets me know that you guys like these kind of videos. If you're new here and want to know I post new videos on the channel, hit that subscribe button. If you're at this point, I'm sure at some point there's another video to click on. I think it's on this side. I don't really know. Click on that video. It'll probably recommend you a video that's similar to this video. But until next time, I will see you in the next video.